I'm told that we've reached quorum, which is good. That's the third year running we've done that at our first meeting. So I'd like to welcome you to this annual general meeting of People with Disability Australia, and also welcome those joining us at the McEwa Hotel via the webcast that's happening today. To start off, I'd like to invite Uncle Madden from the Metropolitan Land Council to welcome us to country. Might need a microphone.
I think they'll hear me.
That's for the hearing loop. Thanks.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Once again, my name is Alan Madden, Gadigal Elder. First of all, two apologies for the terrible weather we're having outside at the moment. Sorry. And not being able to welcome you to my country and my language, as we were forbidden to talk our language a long time ago. I'd like to acknowledge distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to acknowledge our Aboriginal elders, all elders, past and present, and pay my respects. And to all our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander brothers and sisters, from whatever Aboriginal or island nation you may have come from, welcome to Gadigal. And to all our non-Indigenous brothers and sisters here today, a very warm and sincere welcome to you to Gadigal. No matter where you've come from, whether it be across the seas, across the state, or across town, once again, a very warm and sincere welcome to you to Gadigal. And as I've mentioned many times before, was, is, and always will be Aboriginal land. Only three things surer than that: coming, taxation, and going. It is an honour and a pleasure to be here this evening to welcome one and all to Gadigal. Gadigal is one of 29 clans of the Eora Nation. The Eora Nation is bounded by nature's own. The Hawkesbury River to the north. The mobs up that way call it the Darkinjung. The Peon to the west. The Derribin. And George's River to the south. Kaimai. And in between those three mighty rivers is the Eora Nation. And in that nation, 29 clans. And the clans land we're on tonight is Gadigal. On behalf of members of the Metropolitan Local Aboriginal Land Council and of the Gadigal mob, once again, a very warm and sincere welcome to you to Gadigal. And as you travel across these traditional lands, may the spirits of our ancestors guide, look over you, and keep you safe. So once again, on behalf of Land Council and of the Gadigal mob, welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you.
Thanks, Uncle Alan. We feel very, very welcome and we appreciate that. Before getting underway, we've got some housekeeping announcements. Can I just check everybody can actually hear me? And that the hearing loop is actually working okay for the people who need it? Okay, just speak up and let us know if not, or if there's any interruptions. Just in terms of the running order for tonight, we've got David Bowen, who is the head of the National Disability Insurance Agency, joining us a bit later. Now, he's running, obviously, to a schedule. We are delighted to have David, but it means that we'll make some calls about whether we're running to time or not. If not, we might need to go straight through without a break. So what that means is please feel free to get up to grab a coffee or a water or do what you need to do while the meeting is underway. I'll try and schedule a break in, but obviously we'll want to make sure that we get some good time with David and get to ask the questions that I know people are dying to ask David and have been for a number of years here at these meetings. So I'd like to introduce some people who are assisting us tonight, and if they could stand up and identify themselves. Pam Park, who will be our personal care assistant this evening. You could make yourself present known. The back, thank you. The sign language interpreters, we've got two interpreters with us this evening. Those are Jasmine Rosa and Nicola Clark. Thank you for your interpretation. The AGM is also being real-timed captioned, and our captioner this evening is Jason Bradley. We have accessible toilets to the right of the entrance door, and the male and female toilets are located in the same area. At this moment, I'd like to just acknowledge and thank a number of staff who've worked hard on the preparation for this AGM. It's kind of been this year like everything has come together at once. We've had the White Flower Memorial, a whole lot of international commitments and meetings, lots of deadlines come through, and yet people have come together and got the AGM logistics organised, and it's been pretty seamless. So well done and thank you, particularly to Matthew and Therese, to Pete Darby, for managing that process so well. The format of this evening is going to include the formal parts of the meeting as usual, followed by a question and answer session with David. Then we'd like to invite you to join us for refreshments. Up here with me, just in terms of introductions, we have Matthew Bowden, who's the co-CEO of PwC Australia. We've got Suresh Rajan, the treasurer, Stuart Morby, the vice president, and Bonnie Millen, our secretary. At this point, I want to invite Bonnie Millen as our secretary to run through the apologies and proxies, and I think we have a list.
Sure, so the proxies list is Philip Pluck, Nithi Chikaran, Gail Tang Dichamu, Daniela Zapparo, and Lyndall Hunt. The apologies are as follows: Tim Jones, Patricia Byrne, Linda Palmer, Samantha French, Joe Mannix, Kevin Boyce, Rosemary Gray on behalf of St. George Association of People with Physical Disabilities, Aviva Chuba, and Fiona Greenman.
Thanks for that, Bonnie. Can we have a mover or seconder, mover and seconder, that the apologies for the PwD Australia AGM be accepted? Mm-hmm. Thank you. And seconder? Yep. So your name didn't catch? Denise. Okay. Can all those in favour, if you're in favour, just you've got red voting cards, I'm told, which we may need to count if there's, you should have them in your packs. So all those in favour? Yep. Is anybody against? So I think we've dealt with the proxies, yes. So the next item on our agenda are the minutes of the last AGM. The minutes have been posted on our website and have been made available, I think, within the packs tonight at registration. Do people who were actually there at last year's meetings have any corrections to those minutes? Mm-hmm. Okay, so we'll note that for the minutes. Yep. So we've noted that for the minutes, thank you. One of the matters, just want to talk about matters arising before we move to accept those minutes. One of the matters arising was the work on the new draft constitution. A new draft constitution has been developed within consultation with members, expected to begin early in the new year. I'd like to acknowledge the work of the Governance Advisory Group, headed by Stuart Morby, that's been putting this together. Constitutions are a long and important guiding document for the organisation, so a lot of work has actually been taken to get a draft landed. Those of you who were at the last AGM will recall the discussion was around getting a constitution which would conform with the need for PwD to move to a company limited guarantee structure, because we'd had recommendations that that was the best structure that was suited given the size and nature of our business. We've been very fortunate to actually have a pro bono team of lawyers, Gilbert and Tobin, joined us to work on this throughout the year. And it's really important for the future that we actually get this right. So the plan for this is that we're actually going to have a consultation period early in the new year where we'll be releasing that constitution and allowing members to comment on it over a number of months. So can we have a mover and a seconder for the motion that the minutes of the PWD 2014 Annual General Meeting held on 30th of November 2014 be adopted as a true and accurate record of the meeting? Yes. Could you, front? Yep, Frank. And seconder?
Roxana Beda.
Roxana. Okay, all those in favour? Show your red. Thank you. So we now move to the board and financial reports. So just in case you're sort of confused about which document is which, this is the annual report that you would have got coming into the meeting, and I think you would have also got a copy of the strategic plan as well, which we'll be talking about a bit more in a second. So I'd like to formally table this, the annual report of People with Disability Australia Incorporated for the year 2014-15. In doing so, I want to acknowledge the directors and staff who worked to draft and compile the reports. This is, I think, the third year running that we've had these reports out in advance of the meeting, and that is something that should continue. As part of that, I would like to seek leave of the meeting to speak to my president's report. So just to sort of cover the year, I want to make a few remarks. This year, the board has made some important decisions to address structural issues in the budget and operations for PWD. We have concluded revised contracts with the co-CEOs. We've also made a strategic decision to pay out a large amount of time in lieu owed by the association to move some liabilities from our balance sheet and move us into a more sustainable footing in the longer term. And I'd like to thank Suresh Rajan for his counsel and work during these transitions. As I mentioned earlier, the new draft constitution is currently in development with consultation with members expected to begin in the new year. And again, I'd like to acknowledge the work of the governance advisory group. The board has also worked to develop the new strategic directions for 2016-2019. And I'm very pleased to launch this plan tonight on behalf of the outgoing board. The plan better reflects the new work program for PWDA as a national peak and changes in the disability rights movement that have occurred over the last 5 years. This was also included in your AGM information pack, and we've got some more copies available here tonight if you wish to take them away. I'm very pleased at the way the board has coordinated this year, and I wanted to acknowledge the excellent work of Bonnie Millen as our secretary and both of the co-CEOs, Therese Sands and Matthew Bowden, for their secretariat support to us. This has been a year of achievement and considerable change for PWD. Over a decade after becoming a national organisation, I'm looking here at Heidi Forrest, who was part of that decision-making process in 2003-04. We did that, we actually became national. This was the year that PWD Australia actually became an official recognised government national peak, recognised by the Australian government within the Australian Cross Disability Alliance. That alliance also includes Women with Disability Australia, First Peoples Network, and the National Ethnic Disability Alliance. ACTA is the right model for a more unified and coherent voice for people with disability in Australia. It is our opportunity to improve representation for people with disability at a time when we need that representation more than ever. I acknowledge the time and effort that has been put into building the alliance during 2015. An early focus of our work, which some of you who inhabit online spaces would have seen is the End the Violence campaign. And critical work has been going on behind the scenes to shape the governance of the Alliance so that we get it right going forward. This year was also marked by a very important project that you'll be hearing a little bit more over the next couple of hours. The National Disability Insurance Scheme Citizens Jury Scorecard Project was an innovative project that was led by our organisation in conjunction with the National Disability Insurance Agency between September of last year and May of this year. The project used deliberative democracy to involve Australian citizens who helped fund the NDIS and those who have direct knowledge of the scheme as a participant to evaluate the staged rollout of the NDIS in six trial sites. The jury made some findings. It found that the scheme was meeting its objectives overall, but that there was a need for improvements in planning, advocacy, and local area coordination. It also expressed concerns about gatekeeping of people with disability in institutions. Specifically, the advocate witness for the citizens' jury was unable to get into Stockton, despite that being provided with government money and being a disability institution that is funded by the state. A launch of the citizens' jury scorecard and a short documentary about the project took place at the NDIA's national office in Geelong. In May 2015. The public were given an opportunity to actually watch that event online in questions they wanted to ask via a panel of people involved in the citizens' jury process. And in October, if you came in, you probably saw there's a sort of small cluster of awards gathered near the entrance. The jury project was named the International Project of the Year at the International Association of Public Participation Core Value Awards in Perth, longest name for an award series I've ever heard. The project also won the Australasian Project of the Year Award and the Australasian Health Project Award. Sam Connor, who represented us at that event, said it was like being the unpopular people at the ARIAs that just keep winning award after award. What that means is that the project that we won to evaluate the NDIS was judged as not just the best project in Australia, but the best project in the world, up against 60 organisations from Canada, the United Kingdom, the United States. There were places like the Centre for Disease Control in the mix here. So, you know, we really landed a significant project and also puts us in the front seat in terms of influencing outcomes under the National Disability Insurance Scheme. When we held the event to launch the scorecard, the NDIA agreed to hold ongoing juries once every 2 years. So we hope that this will be part of an ongoing process of consumer-led review. We'll be screening a film of the process later in the evening to introduce David Bowen. This year we also welcomed a very different federal budget than last year. Gone were some of the horror measures that we were concerned about last year. There was a small but promising package of initiatives to address employment participation of people with disability. It's not everything that we asked for, but we recognise some of our work actually within those budget measures. And it was again no small achievement to see the NDIS continued to be fully funded with a renewed commitment to deliver on time and on schedule in one of the tightest budget contexts in a long time. In September, we congratulated the Australian, New South Wales and Victorian governments for reaching agreements that will ensure the NDIS rolls out fully in these states as well. And once again, it is good after so many of these AGMs where we've had questions about the NDIS to see the CEO joining us tonight for the first time. The other thing that we would all know has happened this year is we've had federal changes in the leadership, so a new Prime Minister and a new ministry. While we had our differences, I think we should acknowledge the efforts of the previous minister, Senator Fifield, in implementing and holding on and prosecuting the NDIS in what was a difficult context. I hope that we can forge a constructive relationship with the new minister, Christian Porter. Disability issues continue to get traction in the media, and I've been active along with other members of the board and staff in commentary on many issues, from abuse, media portrayals, employment, and restraint in educational settings. A challenge in national policy continues to be the implementation of the National Disability Strategy. I am disappointed in the rollout of the NDS. It lacks purpose, commitment, and rigour. Excuse me. In Canberra recently, I supported Involve Canberra, which is the ACT government's commitment under the NDIS. The approach seeks to harness and combine the efforts of ordinary people, businesses and governments in a series of outward-looking campaigns for change. Approaches like this should be the way that the National Disability Strategy rolls out, rather than a simple checkbox framework. This needs to be more rigorous. And you can be assured that we will continue to press and promote these ideas as we move towards planning our election commitment for the federal election due sometime next year, according to commentary, although it may be next week. I keep hearing different things. In late June, we actually reconstituted a new political action committee in order to plan our key themes and campaign approaches. And the board's actually been meeting over the last 2 days to talk about some of the issues that will frame the election. In the meantime, our individual and group advocacy has supported nearly 2,000 people around Australia over the last 12 months. And I thank our hard-working individual advocates in our offices in Sydney, the Southern Highlands, the Southern Tablelands, Sutherland Shire, the Queanbeyan region, Bundaberg, Fraser Coast, Logan City, Sunshine Coast, and in Mount Isa and the Lower Gulf. Our individual advocacy footprint improves the lives of people on the ground and ensures that we speak with authority in the states, territory, and nationally on all issues. In some years, I think that events conspire to actually push a single issue into the public domain, and we are judged on how well we respond. In 2013, those of you who were around then will recall that it was primarily about the push for the NDIS. Last year, it was about welfare reform. It was about people with disabilities being described as burdens in the national press. This year, I think that the arc of history is bent towards action around rape and violence and murder of people with disability in disability institutions. The summary of that is our work on the Royal Commission into institutional responses for child sexual abuse. PWDA has been funded by the Department of Social Services to support the work of the Royal Commission. We're helping children and people with disability to participate in the commission and making sure that children and adults with a disability can tell their stories if they want to. We had information sessions explaining how we can support people with disability to speak up about the abuse they've experienced or witnessed, and I was pleased to sit in on one of these sessions and see the personal witness provided by Jane Rosengrave, who is on the cover of our annual report, a really remarkable personal witness for this. Excuse me, the cold's getting better on me. We do not have nominations this year for life members tonight, but what I would like to do is to take a moment to thank, by acclamation, all of those who have spoken out against rape and violence this year through the Commission and the inquiry. Their witness is not in vain, and this year we have begun a conversation about how we can prevent abuse and deal with its long trail of consequences at a systemic level. As part of this, I chaired a national forum at Parliament House Canberra on policy responses on the 7th of September. A key focus of that was redress. And last month, we welcomed the federal opposition leader, Bill Shorten's, commitment to establish a national redress scheme for survivors of institutional child sexual abuse in line with the recommendations of the Royal Commission into institutional responses to child sexual abuse. Malcolm Turnbull should adopt that too it is time for action on this issue. PWD was also pleased at the decision to call a Senate inquiry into abuse and neglect. I was awed, frankly, to be part of a really powerful press conference called at Parliament House on the day of the vote for the inquiry, which was fronted by Jules Anderson, who some of you may recognise from the Four Corners program. I'd like to congratulate Sam Connor and other members of the Bolshie Divas for some truly excellent work on the submission to the opening public hearings for the inquiry in Perth. The 40 stories that were pulled into the Uncounted, the report by the Divas, made national press coverage and really landed the case against institutions. Rarely have I been more proud of anything, though, done by the board, than the care that members have put into the White Flower Memorial over the last few months. Led by a board team, including Susie Keane and Sam Connor, with many others. I wanted to invite Pete, if he's around, to make a presentation to Sam and Susie for their work on this. Well done. Now, for those of you who don't know what this was about, and there probably aren't many people that don't know what White Flower Memorial was, but November the 25th marked White Ribbon Day, which is Australia's campaign to stop violence against women. The PWD board, people with a disability, members of the Alliance, families and supporters, came together to lay white flowers at a central location in Sydney, in Macquarie Park, in a national moment of remembrance and mourning for those who have lost their lives in institutional settings. We also had in the lead up to it a campaign where every day we published the name of a person with disability who had died in institutions and the places that they had died. And we did that over a whole month, 7 days a week. I think that shows, firstly, how many of these cases there are, how many uncounted people that there are. We know that untold numbers of our disabled forebears lie in unknown places with no graves to mark them, no words said over their bodies, and no stories told. Some of them were just given a number. They were called Client 8. We will never know every name. But last year we said it was time that we actually had a funeral for those people. When you die, the least to expect is the basic grace and dignity of somebody saying a few words over your body, throwing some dirt down and recognising that you have gone. And many of the people with disability that died in these places never had that basic grace. So doing this was important for us. It was emotional and it was hard to do as well, to actually dig out those stories and to tell them in the way that we did. But at least we have. In doing so, we should not imagine that this is yesterday's issue. It's not. This year, almost every week, has sort of marked a new low on this one. We've had kids locked in cages, coffins, boxes and storerooms. We've had an epidemic of ableism against autistic people who have been demonised in the media by some parents and some in our schools. Parents are let off with murder under the guise of mercy, and an insidious debate imagines us all as better off dead and permits the press, sometimes literally on their front pages, to call us burdens. Like Stella Young, my reaction to this is to say we don't want death with dignity until we get lives with dignity. Now, I've mentioned Stella, and it's really impossible to reflect on the last 12 months without acknowledging the life and contributions of Stella Young. As far as I know, Stella was actually not a member of PWD Australia because she was a journalist, and she didn't believe in actually joining, but in reporting and being part of the journalist cycle. But in terms of disability advocates that were closest to our values and our moral base and the kinds of things that PWD was trying to do, it's hard to think of anybody that was closest to those values than her. I find it hard to speak about her in the past tense. She did more to shake up the disability community and move disability issues into the mainstream than anyone else. We also mourn Madeline Sobe this year, who was part of that energetic YDAS crew from Victoria and had endless promise for our community. As 2015 draws to a close, I wanted to thank the board, staff and members for all of your hard work. In particular, I thank the board and the executive for their extensive work on governance, policy and finance during 2014. I want to acknowledge some people who are stepping down this year, starting with Faye Druitt, who was on the executive for many years, was part of a team that really put into place a lot of governance measures and work along with Heidi and others to rebuild the board over the last couple of years, and I want to thank her for her work. I thank our funders in the New South Wales and Australian governments, as well as the people who sponsor our projects. And finally, I thank our hardworking staff, Matt Bowden and Therese Sands, for their leadership of the organisation, for their cooperation, individual work and labours on advocacy and projects. Thank you. And with that, if my voice holds up, I'm happy to take questions on my report. I think there's one there. Do we need a microphone, Dan?
Did the children that were locked up in cages and cottons get release?
The stories about the children in cages were about children with autism that were being locked in cages during classroom time, and because that was seen as a way of controlling their behaviour as opposed to having a sensory space for them or doing other sort of management techniques within the classroom. One of the things that has been good that happened this year is that every time they've been exposed, those cages have been torn down, ministers have been embarrassed, and they've been forced to change their practices. In the state that I come from, the ACT, they've just released a major inquiry that recommends spending about $70 million for teachers to come up with new ways to ensure that people with autism
are included. They weren't trying to murder the children, were they?
They were trying to restrain them and seclude them, but not murder them. But we know that children were murdered in some of the institutions around Australia, and that's the stories that we saw through the White Flower Memorial.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hello. Joan Hume here. I don't have a question. I have more a comment and an acclamation. That speech that you gave the other day at the White Flower Memorial was one of the most brilliantly eloquent, beautiful and moving speeches I've ever heard. And it rivals, I believe, anything that was ever produced by Martin Luther King. So I just wanted to say thank you for drawing and PWD in general for drawing our attention to this extremely vexing issue of the continued abuse, murder, rape and discrimination against children and adults with disabilities. And I thank you for the work of bringing it to public attention. Whether they take any notice is another matter, but your speech was wonderful, and Samantha's role was so moving, and Susie's too. I was enormously moved by, I'm sorry I had to leave early, but I just wanted people who didn't go there to know that it was deeply appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. Thank you.
I've been in to an institution, but that was a deaf school and that was important, but I never really enjoyed my life there, but I had wonderful parents who looked after me and raised me, So I would like to say that I'm a bit concerned about the NDIS because if I think about my parents, they're quite old now and they've looked after me and I'm now aging myself and finding many barriers in my life. And, you know, I think that it almost is similar to the Holocaust, if you like, where, you know, how can we ensure that we are able to enjoy our futures as well as younger people?
I think I can only agree, really. I mean, I think there are threats on many fronts to people with disabilities. I mean, one of the issues that we've been quite outspoken of as a board is the attitude that some parents and some in the media have towards homicides of children with disability, where it's portrayed as a kind of merciful relief. I mean, we all know the stories where it will be, you know, a mother with a child with autism is let off by a judge and then walks into a paid interview, and the story becomes about her pain. And in fact, this is a murder. And we should be naming murder as murder. We should be naming rape as rape. In institutions, often sexual assault and rape are described as an incident and filed away. Well, actually, it's rape. We need to name these things for what they are. It's one of the reasons I'm personally quite worried about euthanasia, because I think that that will be another euphemism. And there'll be lots of pressures applied to people, an assumption that our lives aren't as worthy as anybody else. Well, having disability pride, which is what Stella tried to teach us, is actually means that our lives are worthy as any other person in the community. So we need to keep pushing back and fighting this stuff in every way. Letters to the editor, submissions to parliamentary inquiries, and in our advocacy work that we do as PWD, and we can never let our lives be minimised, and we can never let other people speak for us, because I think that's also part of the road down. Just conscious there's a bit that we need to move through, including the Treasurer's report, and then we've got David coming in at 7:30, so there's... Yes, that's right. Yeah. So I might invite a mover and seconder for my report. Heidi?
Move it.
Yep. Thank you. Frank? Okay. All those in favour? Against? I declare that carried. Thank you very much. So I'd like to invite our Treasurer, Suresh Rajan, to present the Treasurer's report and the audited financial statements.
Right. Can I just refer you to the page 24 and 25 of that document, that's the annual report that you would have been given as part of your pack. And the full financial report is also contained, is online and is available for anyone who wants to have a look at it. But I just want to highlight a few issues there that just bring you up to date as to how we're travelling financially. You might remember last year that we had a substantial deficit at the end of the year, and we've worked very hard this year to try and reduce that, and we've come some way towards doing that. The revenue has increased from about $2.8 million in 2014 to $3.4 million in 2015. But at the same time, our expenses have gone up, and there was one particular item that caused us some concern. There were some office expenses that had been taken up in the previous year as an expense, and we actually felt that that should be taken out and put into a capital item and then depreciated. So rather than bore you with the technical details of that, all we've done is we've taken out some expenses that had been counted as an item, as an expense item the previous year, put that into our depreciation schedule, and had to increase the depreciation that was claimed. So on page 25, you'll see that the depreciation expense has gone from about $23,000 the previous year to $246,000 this year, which is the reason why we ended up with a net loss for the year of about $266,000. compared to about 500,000 the previous year. So we're heading in the right direction. For the next 12 months, what we've done is as directors, we've all worked very hard to try and make sure that our budgets account for all of the expenses. We've made some structural changes to some of the issues within the organization to make sure that we're not carrying a big liability of time off in lieu and monies owed to the co-CEOs and other staff. We have worked very hard to make sure that all of that will be paid out, and we're budgeting over the next 12 months to have a very, very small deficit of about $30,000. So it appears that we've turned the corner. The auditors are quite comfortable that we are, and they've indicated that in the reports, that they're comfortable that we are putting in place all of these measures that will address some of the structural issues, and we will be in a position where our deficit will be considerably reduced, and hopefully we'll get back into surplus by the following year. So the deficit, as I said, is about $260,000, but about $220,000 of that is accounted for by the depreciation that we had to undertake on office expenses from the previous 12 months. So I'm quite comfortable, as are the auditors, that we are in a position where we're starting to turn the deficit around, and we're now starting to get to the stage where we never intend to be in a position that we will be making a huge surpluses, because that's not the objective of organizations like ours. The objective is to make sure that we actually get to a stage where we are actually spending all of the money that comes in, but not going into drawing down on our reserves, because we do need that for the future. So I think the position is in a far more comfortable position this year than we were in the previous year. And the full financial report is actually online. If anybody wants to have a look at that, they're more than welcome to do so. And the auditor's report and my report are also contained there. I don't know that there's much else there that I'd want to address, but if you have any questions in regard to any of those figures, I'm more than happy to answer them. Any questions at all about the financials?
Questions?
I'd like to think that the organizations would consider that. It is a difficult exercise because one of the things, I guess we get most of our funding by way of grants, and we budget for those grants to be spent in particular fashion. So it is very difficult to, even if we get the reduced price services, that would then go into our budget for when we apply for grants, and then the grants would be reduced to take into account that. So we go into a vicious circle, because all that the grant providers do is give you enough to pay the actual expenses that you will incur. So we can get caught out by saying, okay, well, we've got a reduced expense, and then we'll get a reduced grant.
That I should companies like the internet, the telephone, to say, we will say that you
So do you mean kind of like a cause marketing arrangement where they get recognition for sponsoring us? I mean, we are always approaching sponsors and privates and trying to get people to support us. The reality, though, is that PWD's income is probably always going to be primarily from grants. What makes me slightly less unhappy about the position that we are in this year as opposed to previous years is two things. We, in previous years, probably since the loss of the hotline, those who've been around for a long time will remember what that meant for us. We suddenly lost a third of our business in one go. And since then, our staff have been carrying a large amount of work, mainly unfunded national work, that has resulted in us accumulating large amounts of time in lieu. And I remember being a bit surprised last year at the AGM that we didn't have a kind of revolution when people saw the figures, because we were carrying so much toil. We've made a decision to actually recontract, to manage that in a different way, without going into all the details, but to pay it out in one go. So we've actually thrown a die and paid it out. And the other thing that has happened is because we're now funded as a national peak, that unfunded work is now happily funded. So the onus will be on us to really perform as a national peak, to show leadership and to show we can land it. But PWD is now in a lot happier position than we were last year. We're actually getting funding for the stuff that we actually do, and not just surviving from project to project. So yes, we have to get private involvement and sponsorship, and we're still clawing back stuff every time we can, but for us to actually be in a position where we're coasting towards, not coasting, but clawing our way towards the surplus next year is not where I thought we would be, and I'm pleased that we're there. Are there any other questions? If so, I might invite a motion that the Treasurer's report be accepted from the floor. Tim and Peter. Okay, all those in favour? Against? I'll declare that carried. The next motion is that the audited financial statements for the 2014 financial year be accepted. So that's a technical motion that requires the meeting to accept the financial statements in this report. So can I have a mover for that as well? I got heard Peter again, and I saw Joan. All those in favour? Against? I'll declare that carried. We now turn to the appointment of our auditor. LBW and Partners are our current auditor. We're pretty happy with the services that they provide. I have to say they're pretty rigorous. We always have a conversation with them around this time of the year where they provide us with some frank and fearless advice about our position and help us in our decisions. So the board is recommending that the members appoint LBW and Partners as our association's auditor for another year. Is there a motion for us to do that? Thank you, David and Frank. All those in favour? Yeah. Against? I'll declare that carried. Appointment of public officer. The board wants to recommend, I don't know if he's actually here tonight, but that Mark Tonga, who has been a member of the board over the last 2 years and a high-performing member who's provided us with lots of support and is actually in Sydney, which is handy for signing documents, be appointed our public officer for the next year. So are there any other candidates? I don't know, there's actually a thrilling job. It's about signing things. So can we have a mover and seconder that Mark Tonga be appointed as a public officer? Mover just over here. Labor back. Yep. And Tim. Okay, all those in favour? Against? Carried. So we now turn to the returning officer's report. That report was distributed prior to the meeting, and we've got copies available at the AGM. Just to make a few remarks on the election, because I think that's something we've been trying to do for the past couple of years, is really encourage a democratic process within the membership and the board. There's certainly a democratic process going on within the board at the moment. We had a very contested election for executive positions, which is good. Tim Jones from Corp Vote actually was our independent returning officer. Just some numbers on this. A total of 204 people participated in this election, representing a participation rate of 20.5%, an increase in the 100 people who voted in 2014 and the subsequent 12.5% response rate. Tim Jones has apologised and he's not in attendance, but we'll invite Matt to actually just read the results of the election at this point.
So, as Craig mentioned, this has been mailed out to all members, so I'll just sort of speak at the results. So the candidates who were voted to the vacant positions, Samantha Connor, Alex Jones, Susie Keane, and Justin Ray.
I'd like to...
And Christy Trzyjewski, sorry. Page two. Sorry, Christy.
If you don't get read out, you're not here. I'd just like to... It's really important, I think, that we have. We had 10 candidates standing for 5 positions, so just if people would like to offer a round of applause for all of those who stood and those who were successful. So in order to make the result official, we need to move that the returning officer's report be elected, be accepted, and then those people then take office. So can we have a motion that we accept the returning officer's report? Thanks, Frank. Seconder, Joan, all those in favour?
I just have a question though.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to ask, in the report it says that the unsuccessful candidates were excluded. Does that actually mean that if it was a preferential system that they were, they just didn't get enough votes? Was that what you meant by excluded or...?
It means they were knocked out progressively as the count.
All right, I just needed to clarify that.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
I hope. Is that true? Yes. Okay, so I'll just want to put that to the vote about do we accept the report. Thank you. I'll declare that carried. Well, with that, we've actually grounded ourselves a bit of an early mark because we're ahead of schedule. That doesn't mean everyone can just go. But we will stop for about 20 minutes and then we'll reconvene for the question and answer with David Bowen. So please grab a coffee, mingle, and we'll meet back here at about 7:20. Thank you. I'll close the meeting.
People with disability who are participants of the NDIS appear on screen, providing their personal stories to the jury, either in person or via video link-up. Advocate witnesses, also people with disability, present verbal reports to the jurors, who are seen asking questions and listening to the evidence.
A dark grey textured background. Text appears. Over 4 days in February 2015, 12 randomly selected members of the public came together in one room. They were members of a citizen's jury. Their task was to deliberate on the Federal Government's National Disability Insurance Scheme, the NDIS. The jurors present were Aidan Greenrod, Craig Hughes, Anne O'Grady, Liliana DeSora, Gemma West, Michael Steef, Lorraine Hughes, Darcy Treloar, Kristen Laurent, Chris Ecker, Tony Guillot, and Shaya Mitchell. Craig Wallace, the President of People with Disability Australia.
It's not actually every citizen who gets to render a verdict on one of the most important nation-building reforms that the country has started since Medicare.
Alex Madsen, Director, Governance Section of the National Disability Insurance Agency.
The NDIS is a new way of providing disability supports for all Australians across the country. We're in our trial phase at the moment, but from 1 July 2016, we'll start to roll out across the country.
Craig.
But People with Disability Australia approached the National Disability Insurance Agency with the idea of a completely innovative way to get feedback on the NDIS. And we said, what we could do is have a citizens' jury, which is a process that involves ordinary taxpayers on the ground who are funding the NDIS, hearing from participants who were also randomly selected, and asking them what they're actually experiencing from the scheme. We will hear directly from participants, find out what is actually there to celebrate, what is not stepping up, and what needs to be done differently.
David Bowen, CEO of NDIA.
We recognise that during this trial period, it's important to get as wide and diverse feedback as we possibly can. We recognise there's an enormous amount of interest from people with disability on the performance of the scheme and to have an opportunity to have input into its development. The proposal from People with Disabilities Australia to do this by way of a citizens' jury was one that we thought provided another and different perspective, so we welcomed that.
What is a citizens' jury? Max Hardy, the citizens' jury facilitator.
A citizens' jury is a way of engaging citizens in decision making. And it came about back in the 1970s, and as a way to engage people differently. It's similar to a criminal jury in that we have witnesses giving evidence, and their job is to actually make a determination, to deliberate, to give advice, in this case, to give a scorecard or a report on the NDIS.
How was the evidence presented?
We wanted to actually take the initiative and use random selection to get witnesses to find them randomly and to invite them to come and share their story. So that's actually a unique feature of the citizens' juries.
Craig.
16 randomly selected people with disability who are current participants of the NDIS across 6 NDIS trial sites were asked to interact as participant witnesses and to share their personal NDIS story directly with the jury. 6 advocate witnesses were also recruited and charged with the role of gathering feedback on the NDIS. Using key questions and a random sample of NDIS participants, the advocate witnesses interviewed 45 individuals and held 3 focus groups with people with intellectual disability across the 6 NDIS trial sites. They collated this feedback, providing it as evidence to the jury. PWDA's social media forum was another avenue people could provide feedback to the jury. Posting the same questions used by the advocate witnesses via our Facebook page and Twitter feed, we interacted with a further 78 people across Australia about their experiences and views of the scheme. This feedback was collated and presented as evidence to the jury.
How did the process work? Danielle Annells, the co-facilitator.
So this particular charge has 8 themes for the participants to address.
Themes. Theme 1, putting people at the centre. Theme 2, increasing choice and control. Theme 3, improving portability. Theme 4, reducing fragmentation. Theme 5, uniform understanding of the scheme. Theme 6, addressing unmet needs. Theme 7, community support, linkages and referrals. Theme 8, meeting the goals of greater economic and social inclusion for people with disability. Danielle.
It's a matter of saying, okay, which evidence pertains to which themes, and let's get that captured. So we've created wall space for each of the themes, and we've literally recorded the evidence that we think best sits in that theme. We are also looking at bigger picture type questions and wanting to track those. So overall, what impact do people think the NDIS is having? Overall, what are the issues that we want to know about? As well as sort of looking at, you know, how are people feeling about things, reflections on the day before, so we give the jury an opportunity to hear some evidence and then some processing time and some capturing of that evidence, so that by the time they get to the end of the hearing, they haven't lost some of that key evidence that they heard earlier on. As the days move forward, we start to build an inventory of all the really important evidence, and people are already starting to form some recommendations in their heads and, you know, bashing things around. But on the final day of deliberation, it's like a flurry of activity, of bringing together all those thoughts and really expressing them and checking with each other and starting to find where there's points of contention amongst the jury as well.
Max.
So we try to get a good balance of content, evidence provided, and time to deliberate. And we try and match that time as best we can. So during deliberation, there's different ways that it can happen. We sometimes help to facilitate that conversation, but as they settle into their deliberations, we kind of leave them to it. So there's various methods for doing it. On this occasion, people are writing down the key messages and they're putting it up against various questions that they're meant to answer. And in the end, they'll need to make a collective judgment about how are we going in all these different areas. So to what extent do people have more control, more choice in their life?
The impact on the jurors.
One of the fabulous things about juries, I believe, is the difference that it makes to people who are actually randomly selected. And in this case, like all other juries, people get very excited. And I think it's a wonderful thing to be approached to say, hey, we've got this really complex issue or this thing we need to kind of work on or figure out. Can you come in and help us? So I guess the citizens' jury is also a way of strengthening that whole relationship between government and citizens.
Liliana, juror.
This jury is really important because the NDIS has the capacity to change so many people's lives for the better, and there's kind of this huge responsibility to make the right changes, because every change that gets made is going to impact on thousands of people and potentially millions of people. All Australians eventually might be affected by this.
Shaya, juror.
When I first got the notification about the jury, my first thought was, I've had such a gift given to me here, such an opportunity to be involved in a huge thing.
Kristen, juror.
I was really, really excited to have the opportunity to come and be part of this. So I've been really looking forward to it. And just the opportunity to hear directly from people that are affected by such a huge reform that has the capacity to really improve the lives of people with a disability. So I'm really excited to be a part of it.
The participants of the NDIS. Simone, witness.
It's really important to get the NDIS right and on the right track. The NDIA will shape and change people's lives forever. And it's not people with disability, not just people with disabilities, it's their families. It's their carers that are in organisations, and organisations too. It's everyone.
Brianna and Alyssa, witnesses.
We felt really important to be part of giving back some information about NDIS, didn't we, Brianna? And about your story and your life story and how big a change it's going to make for Bree.
A fresh perspective. Darcy, juror.
I didn't actually understand until I began this today. They're actually not looking to validate the ideas they already have. They're looking for us, the random fresh perspective that we might stumble across.
Craig.
I work in this space every day, but those 12 jurors are completely new. And some of that is going to be quite eye-opening for them. Some of that, it will be shocking. And some of that will actually lift them up to a higher plane. We're wanting that fresh pair of eyes to say, well, we're looking at this almost as if it's for the first time. And how do we objectively assess it? And where do we think that this could actually be improved, both for the National Disability Insurance Agency, for PWD in our advocacy, and for the Australian community as we shape the scheme.
What will happen to the findings? Chris, juror.
Being a part of all this, my one worry coming in, and my one worry still slightly, is that we were brought in to rubber stamp something. That we were just to say, you're doing a good job, and that's all we were here for.
Max.
People have this fear that they get involved in a process and it will go to waste. One of the wonderful things, I believe, about a citizens' jury when it's run well is the prior commitment from the decision makers or the agency in this case to use the report to respond to it publicly.
Craig.
So the commitment is that there is going to be a scorecard which is being presented over the next couple of days as the jury unfolds. We're going to be presenting that to the agency. People with Disability Australia, once that is finalised, is going to be making that available to First Ministers who signed off on the scheme to ensure that the results of it are actually acted on.
Alex.
The Citizens Jury is another great way for the NDIA to respond to participants. Hearing from people with disability is important for the scheme to grow. People with disability built the NDIS and they will continue to build the NDIS to ensure it's there for future generations to come.
Some recommendations from the jurors. Gemma, juror.
We've come to the end of day four and we haven't quite got to the end of the process, so we have come up with a whole lot of recommendations and good points and areas for improvement. So we started off with a summary of the fact that the jury unanimously thought that it was a great idea. Its ethos was sound and it will deliver great things for the disability sector in Australia. It was surprising for 12 people how we unanimously agreed on pretty much every point of what was a recommendation.
Shaya.
I think the role of the planner is paramount to the success of the scheme for the individual.
Liliana.
The main focus needs to be consistency, learning from what works and applying it in the areas that might be weaker.
Kristen.
If there were one thing that I think needs attention other than the planner training, I think it's capacity building for participants to equip them to be able to get the absolute best from their goal setting, their plan development and the execution of their plans and choice of providers.
Aidan.
More advertising for the NDIS itself outside of it. You need to get that message out to people why the NDIS is needed and why it's a good thing, because most people wouldn't have an idea. They just have no idea what it's like. And that's something that my eyes were opened up to throughout this whole process.
Chris.
Because the scheme is self-driven, from what I've seen in the last week, those people with the greatest support have had the greatest outcomes. And my worry is that those people without that support won't have the same outcomes, and that's just my fear for the system.
Mike.
I'd like to leave you with a little philosophical point. Society is judged by how it treats the lowest members of that society and the least one with the least amount of power. If you can empower those people, then your society will flourish. If you don't, you'll perish.
The image of Michael's face disappears. The screen fades to black.
A graphic appears. Various pictogram people stick post-it notes on a wall. Text reads, "The jury was unanimous in affirming the intent, ethos and rationale for the NDIS. The graphic disappears. Another graphic. Three pictogram people with disability assist each other abseiling up the side of a mountain. To the right of the screen, four pictogram people with disability are hoisted up on a suspended platform. The text reads, "Unquestionably, the NDIS is already enabling quality of life outcomes for some people with disability that would otherwise be unattainable." The final graphic is a construction site. A crane lowers large alphabet letters, NDIS. Pictogram people with various disability assist with the letters arrangement and placement. The text reads, "The jury's report will help strengthen the NDIS towards full implementation." A slow fade to black screen. The credits roll. PWDA would like to thank the participant and expert witnesses, Edwina Barker, supported by husband Arthur Barker, Cindy Zabierski, on behalf of son Max, Taryn Waters, on behalf of son Rufus, Michaela Banks, on behalf of son Harry, Anne Malloy, on behalf of son Dylan, Sarah Downey, supported by mum Anne-Marie Downey, Tom Dow, supported by Rylan Finch, Linda Blake, Gary Hill, Jacinta Kelly, supported by dad Edward Kelly, Anne Faulkner, Bob Buckley representing son Kieran, Brianna Grant Griffin, supported by mum Alyssa Griffin, focus group representative Simone Stevens, supported by Ellie Blackney, advocate witnesses Angela Chanchosi, Jane Wardlaw, Kerry Telford, Christy Chachewski, Crockett Cook and Justin Ray. The jurors, Liliana DeSora, Chris Ecker, Aidan Greenrod, Tony Guio, Craig Hughes, Lorraine Hughes, Kristen Laurent, Shaya Mitchell, Anne O'Grady, Michael Steef, Darcy Treloar, and Gemma West. New Democracy logo. PWDA would like to acknowledge the support from NDIA in making the Citizens Jury possible.
Logos follow. The NDIA, National Disability Insurance Agency logo. PWD logo, People with Disability. Max Hardy Consulting logo. SASCOM logo. And Think Films logo. The audio description was prepared by Eliza Lovell. This film visually presents a range of speakers who have been interviewed about the project.
I hope that's given you an insight into the citizens jury process that was undertaken earlier this year, to reflect on that process and also to take many questions that we've had from members and also questions from the floor. It's my very great pleasure to invite David Bowen, the CEO of the National Disability Insurance Agency, to join us here tonight. To introduce David, David is the inaugural Chief Executive Officer of the National Disability Insurance Agency. He has worked as a consultant to the insurance industry and to the health and disability sector. He's one of the architects of the New South Wales Lifetime Care and Support Scheme, and as the inaugural CEO, was responsible for the implementation of this initiative. Prior to this, he was the General Manager of the Motor Accidents Authority for 11 years. David is a lawyer by profession, but we won't hold that against you, and with a strong background in administrative and insurance law. He's been actively involved in development of the Disability Reform Program, being a member of the independent panel advising the Productivity Commission in its inquiry into the feasibility of an NDIS, and as the initial chair and ongoing member of the National Injury Insurance Scheme Advisory Group. I just want to talk for a second about how tonight is going to work. We've got a web stream happening, so we've got people joining us from around Australia. There is a hashtag. That hashtag is NDIA, capital Q-A-N-D-A, because we couldn't think of anything a bit more elegant than that. So if you're wanting to lodge questions, please lodge those via Twitter and Facebook. What we have an agreement from David is that if we can't get to some of the questions that have been lodged online, we will be taking those, compiling them together, sending them to the agency, and the agency will be providing a response that we can put on our website so that we answer as many of your questions as possible. We do want to actually create a space for as many questions as possible from the floor tonight. David has kindly agreed to be with us until just after 9 p.m, so hopefully there will be lots of time for questions. Please say your name if asking a question, and we'll also try and take questions from as many different people as we can. So we know that lots of people have got lots of individual questions, but we want to try and give everyone a chance to have a say. I'd like to just start off, I guess, by asking David, having just re-seen that film, to reflect on the jury process and what the agency actually learned from it.
Thanks, Craig, and thank you to People with Disability Australia to join you here tonight. Craig came and saw me, I think, about 6 months before we did the citizens jury, and pointed out to me something that I was only too acutely aware of, that the scheme at that early point in time was undergoing multiple reviews around financial sustainability, reviews around how we undertook assessment, or reviews around how we intersected with state government services. And all of these brought different perspectives, and often I think we felt people were trying to find reasons for it to fail rather than reasons for it to succeed. But Craig made the point that none of these reviews were really driven by the two critical stakeholders in any system, and those are the people who pay for it and the people who benefit from it. And so we needed to get those perspectives in it. And I confess I hadn't heard of a citizens jury before Craig dropped it on me, but I am fundamentally a great believer that if you're developing anything, the wider input you can have, the better. and you get a stronger product when you allow it to be up there and open to criticism and suggestions and recommendations, and you take that within the spirit that it's given, that it's about building something even better. Certainly one of the fundamentals that we have within the agency is that, number one, we're not the owners of the NDIS, we're part of the ownership structure, but we're not the owners. It came out of a campaign really by people with disability, making the logic of the argument and making the case unassailable. And the second, not only we're not the owners, we're not even necessarily the experts. We bring some expertise to bear, but I say in relation to our planning, the person with the disability is the expert in their own life, and our job is to assist and facilitate them understand what sort of supports might help them achieve their goals. So three takeouts from me, other than our response to the individual recommendations. The first is that you build better schemes by being robust, by being open to criticism, by being open to input. And we have this learn, build, deliver tagline we use in the agency as one of the three core fundamentals to the agency's culture, and the others being the values of performance and learning. And I think that's a pretty good mix. The second is that we had set ourselves up to get feedback both quantitative through surveys and qualitative, but our qualitative was as organisations often do, it was essentially passive, where people could drop suggestions into us, and this much more at the citizens' jury is a form that is much more active qualitative feedback. It's also, unlike all of those other reviews, it's holistic. It's looking at the whole system, not trying to isolate bits of it. And that's really important. If you want to get a sense of how things are working, you need to look at the whole system operating. I'd like to think that we took it on board, that we have learnt some lessons out of the individual recommendations, that we've also embedded that learning into our culture even more. Some of the activities that we've been doing around developing full scheme, insofar as the agency controls those elements of it, have been with a very deliberate policy around co-design of bringing people in who will inform us around the development of it. And at some point in the future, after we've got a bit of the full scheme under our belts, we'll have another shot at it.
David, just a staging question that reflects many of the questions that we've had online. Many of the people here have been waiting for decades for essential equipment, for care and support. We've got people right around Australia, including in regions that aren't covered. Is there a simple answer to the question, when and how will the NDIS be rolled out to everyone around Australia?
There's unfortunately not a simple answer to that. It's on a jurisdiction by jurisdiction basis. At this point in time, there are agreements for New South Wales and Victoria to start full scheme in July next year. ACT already being, well, it's a trial, it's a whole jurisdiction trial, so that's already on its path to having everyone in the ACT in by about this time next year. New South Wales will be a geographic rollout in two stages, but over 3 years. So it splits the state in half geographically, not by the amount of land, but by the number of expected participants. And for the first group, they all start on the 1st of July over about 2 years, and in the other locations, they start 1st of July 2017 over 2 years, with a big emphasis upon bringing people who are existing clients in state disability services and supports in first. Victoria's also starting geographically, but they're starting a staged geographic rollout, so it starts in one area of Victoria in July, and then it progresses to some others, and it continues that trajectory over about, over about 3 years, again with a focus on existing clients coming in early, with some statewide programs sitting over the top of that geographic rollout, focusing really upon reducing wait lists, of which there are quite a few in Victoria. At this stage, there are no other states that have agreements, but I think it's fair to say, because ministers have said this, it's fairly close with a couple of others, and we're fingers crossed we'll get some good announcements before Christmas. The only state that hasn't signed up to full scheme at this stage is WA, which is still dependent upon an evaluation between two trials there, one conducted by the NDIA and one by the WA Disability Services Commission. Now, if you want to see the details of all of that for New South Wales and Victoria, it is on the agency's website.
Thanks, David. I'd like to now take our first question from the floor. We'll alternate between questions from the floor and questions online. So do we have any questions? Jonathan. We'll just wait till we get the microphone to you. Yep, go.
What makes with the NDIS take to encourage self-determination within the management structures of disability support organisations, and is it feasible to require that for a organization to be registered with the scheme, they must have an consumer advisory committee to that the consumers, not commercial interests, are at the heart of why these providers operate.
There's a fair bit in that one.
Yes, there sure is. Let me address a number of those issues, and thanks for that question. The legislation not only permits, but in fact instructs the agency to facilitate people self-managing their supports insofar as possible. The statistics, I think, at the moment belie the reality of that happening. In our reports, you will see that around about 3% of participants in the scheme currently self-manage, and that means they get their whole package going into a bank account, a separate bank account, and they are quit for the supports that they get through that package. There's some significant limitations on self-management at the moment, the main one being that a lot of supports are provided to the agency by what's called in-kind supports from the Commonwealth and the states, and you cannot manage an in-kind support. So whenever anyone has an in-kind support, they can't fully self-manage. The better statistic that we have is that round about 28 to 30% of participants self-manage some part of their package, and that is at the largest end, people who, for example, choose to self-manage transport, but they go to providers to both provide and manage other aspects of their support, through to the reverse, where people self-manage everything apart from those bits that the in-kind bits that can't happen. The agency set some targets to increase this. Number one, we have to get rid of the in-kind because it is just that barrier. It is not consistent with choice and control, and it's a barrier to self-management. We've nevertheless set a target for year one, for people coming in year one, of 10% of the people who enter the scheme will not only self-manage, but they will in fact be able to self-plan. And we'll have the tools in place on the website that people can develop their own plans and then manage their own plans. Our target is to increase that to 20% in year two. Now, I have to say, internationally, that's quite an ambitious target because it's taken some areas 5 to 10 years to get there. But our independent advisory council has suggested to me that they'd like us to have a stretch target that we eventually get to 40% or more people who are self-planning and self-managing. And that's quite good from the agency's point of view because it makes sure that we focus on having all of our systems and processes that allow that to occur. It doesn't force people to do it. That is, at the end of the day, it's an option, but it allows it to happen. I reckon some of this is a little bit generational. If you look at Tasmania, where we have those 15 to 24-year-olds, say, our rates of self-management are way higher than anywhere else because you say to a young person, do you want to self-manage? They say, sure. They don't have established relationships with providers, and they're probably, as your young people are, a little bit more fearless, a little bit prepared to take a risk. And I think that's a great thing, and we try and support and encourage that. The issue of people with disability as consumers is quite a critical one. A lot of the discussion of the market tends to focus on who's going to provide the services and supports, and a market only works if there's got consumers in it. And to be a consumer, you need to have the information and you need to have the capacity to exercise the choices that might be available. You need to be an empowered consumer. And so a lot of what we're looking at through our funding for information linkages and capacity building is around that capacity building. For example, I had an excellent meeting with a Victorian group called the Self-Advocacy Resource Unit, bringing together a variety of organisations through a lot of different disabilities. It's very strong in Victoria, but it's very undeveloped elsewhere around Australia. And we'd like to see those sorts of self-advocacy arrangements really be a critical component of this scheme, so that we're not just trying to honour the person's wish, we're actually allowing them to express it. It's a big challenge for our service providers as well. I think it's the single biggest challenge at the moment. They're all focused on business plans and prices and all those other elements. The first thing I'd be doing if I was running a service provider would be I'd be going and talking to my existing clients and saying, what do you want that's different? Because until you're responding to your current clients as consumers, you're left with what too many of these organisations, well-intentioned as they are, that they know better what people really want. And you should, what's happening, that proves that wrong, is in this, people mostly in their first plan go back to their existing provider. In the second plan, the churn's starting to happen because they say, I'm not particularly happy with all of this, I want something different. And the market's not there yet because they're not listening to the consumers and it's not in scale. And I think that is, I think that's probably the big issue over the next 5 years is to get that side of the market right.
Via the magic of Twitter, we've actually had two questions that sort of segue from your last answer. The first one is from New South Wales Council for Intellectual Disability. They've tweeted, why is the information linkages and capacity building investment so small? $114 million of an $8 billion scheme. And what's being done to promote advocacy and self-advocacy, particularly by people with intellectual disabilities within the scheme?
Yeah. Oh, I think I've covered the self-advocacy. Yeah. At the moment, we don't know whether that $140 million is a small, it's a small amount in the size of the whole scheme, but a lot of what's currently called ILC type of activities funded through the Commonwealth and states, which collectively don't add up to that amount, so there is more money in there than's currently being provided. A lot of what's currently funded, what the states and the Commonwealth call ILC, is in fact supports that would be purchased through people's packages. And so there is the amount of new money is more than the difference between what's currently there and the $140 million. It is making sure that people have that ability to buy those supports in a marketplace. And then the ILC work, I think, does focus on those elements of the information out there, and the agency itself has a big responsibility there. The linkages, and that's not only delivered through organisational response, it's delivered through our local area coordination. And the local area coordination will not be delivered by the agency. We see that as being delivered in the community services sector, close to where people are. And the third one, the capacity building, I think is the predominant focus of where ILC funds should be looking at. What we're trying to do with this, of course, is a very difficult task of matching funding, which is quite limited in year one and grows over those 3 years, at the same time while state and Commonwealth funding is running down or converting to purchase supports without creating any gaps. So it's nearly an impossible task, but we've got an end vision in sight. Quite an extensive consultation on the framework for ILC, and the agency will be very shortly releasing its approach to commissioning. We don't see this as a grants program. We want to make this around commissioning supports in the ILC space that assist for good outcomes. We want it to be, as the whole scheme is, outcome focused. But in relation to that, the point around self-advocacy, you probably gathered I'm a very, very strong believer that that is a fundamental primary focus of that funding.
Thanks, David. I've seen a question from the floor from Justin Ray.
Hello, Justin Ray, advocate witness for the thing. I've been thinking about this whole thing for a long time. The citizens' jury gave me the opportunity to really have a good look at the NDIS. I know this is probably something like a myriad of other questions that possibly couldn't be answered, but I'm going to say it anyway. I want to know if there is, I mean, yes, you could almost say the ILC is a very customised option. I am applying for the NDIS just to see if it will be there for me, but is there a customised option for any of these things right across the board of the NDIS?
Sorry, Locke, what was the last one, Mike?
Sorry, I didn't really say. So I wanted to find out whether or not a customised package would ever be made for people like me, because I don't present as having a disability, and yet I do. Can that give you an idea?
Sure. So the ILC funding is not individualised. It's to go out to really organisations to provide services and supports for all people with disability in that information linkages capacity building space, including people who might come in as participants in the scheme, but not substituting things that people might get through packages. So the real issue is there are many people around the cusp of the scheme, and we we see this, who are particularly difficult group, not difficult in the sense they create difficulties, but in terms of locating and engaging people with psychosocial disability who have episodic support needs. So we make contact, they don't need anything at the moment, and so they're easy to lose track of. So making sure you've got the infrastructure in place so that when people need support, they can come in and engage is really important. But if you have a support need at a level that gets you into as a participant, then you know, come in and have that discussion. It is not diagnostic based. We try and use diagnosis to help people self-identify whether or not they may be covered, but it's not the determining factor. It is around functional impairment and support need arising from that. And once you've got a package, it is individualised, and to that extent it's customised to the person, and with some limitations that predominantly under the person's control as to where and how they and on what they spend the funds. Clearly they've got to be supports relating to that impairment, but how they move that around within that's within the person's control.
I've got a question that's come in via Twitter and via Facebook. Under NDIS, people with disability under 16 are now not supported with the cost of transport to therapy, such as hydrotherapy. Is that true and why?
No, what's happened is that the transport's been moved out of individual line items and rolled into packages, and in getting some benchmark indications of what will go in packages, we came up with some classification systems to try and make sure it's there. And it's been, I believe, interpreted, and perhaps the agencies misinform people, that that's a limit on what you can spend on transport rather than seeing it's just a function in a person's package. So we do pay for transport where a person has a disability-related transport need. That's a really important point to make, because people with disabilities, as for many other citizens, will not be able to access a whole range of activities if there is no suitable public transport. And that is not something that the NDIS will step in and pay for, because we're not a transport funding organisation, we're a disability funding organisation. However, we have started down the track of looking at how we can be more efficient in providing transport for those people who have a disability-related transport need. We had a transport forum up in Newcastle, which I spoke at about 3 weeks ago. One of the extraordinary things out of that is that through a bit of a stock take, we have found in the Hunter over 500 accessible vehicles, mostly used for 2 to 3 hours a day. And if single organisations think that they can get the capital cost of running a bus and putting it on the road for only 2 hours a day back through a transport fee from the NDIS, it will never be economic. But there's markets do lead to innovation. There's a chap up there who's now creating a market where organisations who have this transport can hook up with drivers and start to allow people with disability to book transport when they need it. You know, a lot of those buses at the moment pick people up when the bus says it's coming, when the organisation says it's coming. So this is saying we're not short of the infrastructure. We've got all of these vehicles there in a place like the Hunter. We're just not using them very efficiently, and we're not using them in a way that meets the needs of consumers. And so that can be tackled as a transport problem rather than as a disability problem.
What makes it a transport problem and not a disability? I mean, just sort of thinking about that, it's almost like an Uber for if you...
That's right, and that was the example. And and there's no reason why it couldn't be expanded to people with a disability who may not have a transport-related disability need, but may be in a location where they nevertheless have a transport need. And what makes it is really if you can get on to a bus or a train, but there are no buses or trains running, that's a transport failure, not a disability support failure.
So the principle is that the NDIS wouldn't pay for the costs of, say, a wheelchair taxi just to get around in your normal business?
No.
Yep. Have we got questions from the floor? Rose.
Hi.
Just wanted to get the microphone. Thanks.
Hi, Cheryl here. I'm a person with disabilities. I'm the mother of people with disabilities. I recently, in my role as my daughter's mum, had to work out her support hours that she needs for a week, and it works out that her support needs actually run at about 2 hours for every waking hour of her life. So it's like there are two people actively doing something on her behalf for every hour that she is awake. So how is the NDIS going to deal with that? Because she's not the only one. There are many people with the same level of need.
So that's just part of the assessment and part of the plan development. There are people in the current disability support systems who have 24, 28, 48, in some cases 72 hours of care per day, because they have 3-to-1 staffing ratios. And one of the things for us is to make sure that the supports are there when people need it, but also to see whether through better housing and whether through, if it's possible, to build capacity and capability for people to improve self-care, that you can reduce that. And that's not about saving money for the scheme, it's about enabling people to do more for themselves. And we have, I'll just take a moment to mention this one. We've been doing a lot of work with the people coming out of Calandra in Barwon, which is a residential institution, and we've been quite often with complex needs, which is usually a euphemism for significant behavioural problems. And we've set up a residential intervention service there. And the provider we have, and I think this is the future of what we want providers to look at, talks about their role is to support the person while diminishing their involvement in that person's life as they empower them to do more for themselves. And they're my pin-up provider at the moment, because that's a wonderful philosophy to have. We had a young man in there who'd been there 3 years, locked in a room. So he was isolated and segregated, moved into the residential facility. Now, one of the things with the insurance system, we actually put more support into him to build up his ability to socialise with other people and to start to care for himself. Only 2 years later, his package has dropped from over $500,000 to under $300,000. He's still living in that support. He still needs high levels of care, as a $300,000 package would suggest. But he's now going out and he's doing vocational training and he's heading towards the workforce in the future. So I often have this discussion with people who say, oh, but there's all those people you can't do anything with. You know, you just can't do anything with them. And the answer to that is there may be some people that, but if you start with that philosophy, you'll never do anything.
I'll do one online and then I've got one from Suresh. Just in terms of vulnerable people, of the kinds of people that you were just talking about there, we've had a question online about how will the NDIA consider the recommendations of the Senate inquiry into abuse and neglect. of people with disabilities, and also on the tail end of that was how can we expect people with disabilities to be safe and protected if there's no support for systemic advocacy?
Okay, so the NDIA is not the policy authority for quality and safeguards. That will continue to be over these next two or three years through existing state systems while the Commonwealth and states work out a new system. Nevertheless, you wouldn't be surprised that we have a view on that. Number one, there should not be a one-size-fits-all approach. That's quite critical. The level of risk associated with people's circumstances varies as much as all of the individuals who may be participants in the scheme, and we have plenty of people in this scheme who need nothing more than normal consumer law to manage their relationship with a provider. Secondly, the focus on safeguards should not create a system of benevolent cotton wooling of people that doesn't allow people to exercise choice or that constrains choice or that limits the opportunity for people to take risk. And one of the critical, probably the most critical thing we believe in that is that you have to have open systems, that closed systems are what create vulnerability. Open systems diminish vulnerability. The most vulnerable people in our scheme already are those who have no one in their life other than a paid worker, and they're closed system. And it doesn't mean just an institution. It can be a single house in a community, can be a closed system. It's not in the community just because it's plonked in a suburb. So having open systems, I think, is probably the critical issue for those people whose vulnerability doesn't allow them to defend themselves either physically or verbally or report abuse, and they're the people who need to expand the number of people in their lives, and that's the way we get safeguards.
I'm going to take a question from Suresh.
David, it's Suresh Rajan. I'm on the board of PWDA and also the president of the National Ethnic Disability Alliance. And can I just preface my question by giving you a little bit of context so that you can look at that, the answer to that question? One of the issues that troubles people from a non-English speaking background and also from the Indigenous community is the fact that often there are languages in which you cannot actually find interpreters or translators anywhere in Australia. Other than a family member. And the issue that has been troubling us for a long time is this question of whether it is possible to employ a family member to provide the care and what are the circumstances under which it will be appropriate for those family members to be employed. And I suspect I know what the answer that you're going to give me is that it's currently being researched and you will come back to us at some stage. But and a second part to that, if you like, is this issue around the philosophical issue of whether taxpayers are entitled to taxpayer-funded services such as NDIS. And what I mean by that are people on temporary residency visas, 457s, student visas, and asylum seeker visas are not provided disability services under the NDIS because for some reason that's excluded from the NDIS.
Sure. So let me answer the issue around family members first. And this is a difficult one. I concede that. We don't have a complete prohibition on it, but we certainly have a strong view away from paid family members, and the reason's twofold. One is that the scheme starting point should be around sustaining and maintaining natural family supports and then providing the additional paid supports that's needed over the top of that. And if you muddy that separation, then you end up creating a circumstance in which the functions of the family are transferred to one of being paid care providers instead of natural family supports. The second thing, and this has been actually something that's happened in other systems where, and the best example is New Zealand, where their accident commission introduced paid family care at a lower rate, at one third of the normal rate. They thought they'll be clever, we'll allow it to happen at one third of the rate. And there was an expansion in how many care hours people needed. But secondly, it created an economic relationship between the person with a disability and the family member that made it very hard if the person wanted to move and move on somewhere else. So that's critical. Having said that, there's always exceptions, and we recognise that culturally appropriate care may sometimes require that exception to be to occur. In those circumstances, however, it is important for us that family member be properly employed and trained and have the coverage of being an employee of an organisation rather than just a direct contribution to the family. So they should be, in fact, a paid care worker. And I'm not sure whether we've facilitated any of those yet, but we have the capacity to do that. The Indigenous, well, certainly the remote Indigenous communities are ones in which we're looking at different types of models around community support as distinct from individual care support. Now, what was the issue of the residency restrictions is written into the Act. Craig's probably going to ask me about age 65 in a moment, because I don't think I ever go to a forum where I don't get asked about that. Look, they were decisions that were made when the legislation was written. I have to administer it as it is. Certainly there's been a big push in the press recently around access for people from New Zealand. And I'm sure it's elsewhere, all those other groups you said as well, but that's one that I can, you know, in very best public service speak, say you need to take up with the ministers.
Having been given that invitation, David, we know that you're not making the policy around the age limit for the scheme, but this is an issue that's come up repeatedly for our membership, some of whom have been fighting all of their lives for disability supports and are sort of butting up against that 65 years age group. In the ACT, they actually rolled in people that were 64 so that they could get into the scheme before the age cutoff happened. I mean, what do we say to people who've been fighting all their lives for disability support and might miss out?
Look, well, two or three things. One, you know, that age restriction is written into the legislation, so it does need a policy change. Number two, if you're eligible for the scheme and you get access before 65, then you can age in the scheme. You're not kicked out when you turn 65. That's quite important. And secondly, or thirdly, over the transition years, so over the next 2 to 3 years of transition, there is a commitment from the government for continuity of support. So if people age over 65 and in existing disability supports, they'll get that continuity over that period of the agreement. Now, what happens in the longer term, I can't say at this stage, because I don't know. I don't know.
So when you say it needs a policy change, you're saying...
It needs a legislative change. It would need a legislative change. And the issue with... I mean, to some extent, this is a point-in-time issue, isn't it? Because from now on, everyone will come in and age in the scheme, other than for those people who acquire their disability over the age of 65. And one of the reasons that governments looked at and agreed to that 65 limit is there is a significant upsurge in age-related disability after 65. Macular degeneration, you know, extensive hearing loss, the prevalence of stroke increases significantly, and they all come with quite high costs. The Productivity Commission, of course, was looking at aged care at the same time as it was looking at the disability. It did suggest that the two schemes should be complementary in being consumer-directed and consumer-focused, but it's probably also fair to say it saw that enablement component around disability as being much more applicable to disability sector than it is to the aged sector, where it's more about appropriate care going into the future.
Sam Connor has been wrangling social media and collecting some questions online, I believe, while we've been talking. You got one for us?
I have about 40, but I'll give you one. So this question is about employment. It says, the NDIA proudly publishes statistics around the employment of people with disability. I have two questions. One is that given the numbers of people with disability in the scheme with an autism spectrum disorder or intellectual disability, how many employees are employees of the NDIA with those disability types? The second is how many people with disability are working in the top rungs of management?
Okay, so yes, we do take some pride in our statistics around disability. We set ourselves a target initially of 12% based on that being significantly higher than any other public sector organisation, or indeed I suspect any other commercial organisation, with a few very isolated exceptions, and we've hit that early. We have two other measures which are worth mentioning before I talk about the profile of people with disability in the executive. The second one is we have a measure around lived experience for disability. So if you go to South Australia, where we're dealing with children, well, we don't have very many children. We don't have any children who are employees of the agency, but over 50% of our staff in South Australia are the parent of a child with a disability, or in some cases a sibling. So it's very high levels of that personal lived experience, not paid lived experience, personal lived experience. We also have now, out of 1,000 staff, we have 50 of our staff who are actually participants in the scheme. So they have a level of support need that enables them to be in our scheme. And so we actually have a staff participant network, which is, from the agency's point of view, a very powerful group, because they give us immediate feedback on the organisation as an employer, and they also bring a participant's perspective to the work that we do. Amongst the senior echelons were around about that 15% as well, from my recollection of the statistics. We've just maybe known to many of you employed Marianne Diamond as our General Manager of Media and Communications, so she's in that space. We have other people with disability at other senior executive levels.
Other questions, David?
just going back to the question of age 65, given advances in medical science, rapid ones, is that 65 a number set in stone? I mean, I can foresee that perhaps, like, whilst people are living longer, medical science is improving. I hope, anyhow, that there are less people over 65 the need for the NDIA. And can I just sneak in another question, and that's a quick one about surveillance of, awful word I know, surveillance of providers. Historically, I mean, I've been involved in disability sector for a while, and there have always been cases where providers have been able to do rather better than the government thought they might have done out of it.
So let me answer the first question first. The 65 cut off for access to the scheme is written in the legislation, so it needs an amendment to the Act to change that. So that's not set in stone, but it's a hard measure. It's not something easily changed. In terms of, I'm going to interpret the surveillance issue a little bit more broadly, and that is what changes when you change from a system in which the government contracts with providers to one in which they're providing services to consumers, and consumers decide who and to where they'll go and get their supports, is that the reporting on how providers are doing is no longer against a whole lot of government-imposed output measures. It's around what the clients think about the service. And when I talked about consumers needing to be informed previously, one of the obligations the agency sees ourselves having is to set up the mechanisms by which information about providers can be shared, including consumer ratings of the services, because we think that that type of direct consumer feedback shared with other people is a very powerful tool in improving services. And we will supplement that with outcomes in terms of, we've built an outcome framework, we're about to go out publicly with it, presenting it to the states early next week, and then after that, because I always have to present it, Commonwealth and states first, multiple governance structures here. We'll then come out for a wider consultation on that, but we have done a lot of co-design around that. We've had a lot of input already. Our intention is that that outcome framework will allow us over time to put information into the marketplace that indicates what type of services and supports, and including the provider, leads to better outcomes. And those outcomes are around independence, quality of life, economic and social participation.
Okay, I'm going to go to, is it Jonathan again?
My name is Anna, and I'm Jonathan's mother and carer. Hi. And I also have a daughter with disability, and she suffers mental illness. How is NDIS supporting people with mental illness, especially if the condition is sometimes bad and sometimes even worse?
Sure. Two things on that. Firstly, we actually have quite a number of participants in the scheme we're from mental illness, psychosocial, psychiatric impairment. In fact, we have about the number who were expected, so that's going all right from that point of view. We are looking at ways in which people can drop in and out of the scheme as their support needs vary, and do that quickly, because people who are clinically stable and living in the community may not need any supports at all, but at the point they need them quickly, and so we want to be able to respond. Where we still have a lot of work to do, and you'll be aware that the government's response to the Mental Health Commission report came out only yesterday, is in making sure that there is a good alignment between the clinical support provided through the health system and the mental health system and the community support provided by the agency. And so we'll now use the Commonwealth Government's response to the Mental Health Commission report, which talks about individualised approaches, talks about collaborative arrangements with the NDIS where there is overlap, to work very hard at making sure that it's not you go over there for your clinical services and then you come to the NDIS for community support. Those two have to work together, because often it's one that triggers the other.
I want to go to one of our pre-submitted questions that is about pricing. which is, I'm sure, an issue that you're asked about at many of these forums. And the comment from the person was that some of the pricing for the NDIS for personal care and support is low and encourages people to pool their resources together. There's concern that this will take away choice and control, as it could force people to live in more congregated environments or force people to have to choose the same service provider for support as they already have. Do you think we've got pricing right?
Pricing's an ongoing piece of work. The issue is we have lots and lots of prices, as you would expect, and this really boils down to one very significant issue, and that is the hourly rate for personal care support, which is by far the single biggest component of expense in this scheme. We constructed our pricing from the bottom up. That started with an expectation that providers would pay at award rates, and then made allowances for all of the variables that would impact upon reasonable service delivery, including the utilisation of labour, including what we call the span of control, so how many supervisors and managers and executives do you have to the frontline staff, and included corporate overheads that include things like training. After we put those prices out, we had a lot of feedback from the sector that the prices were too low for them to continue to provide services, and we undertook some work with NDIS to build up a pricing framework. And that framework really identified those three issues four issues. What's the base rate that the staff are being paid? And we know that for some, but not all organisations, there are enterprise agreements that are above the award level, so we need to factor that in. Secondly, that the providers needed to pay attention to labour utilisation, to span of control, and particularly to corporate overheads. So we are prepared to continue to look at pricing, but we want to see the same preparedness from the sector to look at those other elements. And if I can deal with that third one, we have providers who have corporate overheads of 40% of our rate. So it's not that the labour costs, we're not allowing enough for the labour costs, it's that they're just not operating very efficiently. And rather than push it back into changing labour rates or changing the way in which people get supports, we really encourage this sector, and in fact want to help this sector make the transition to being more efficient business operations. Because on the issue of what does this mean for participants, we actually cap the amount that a provider can charge to our rates. So we regulate the prices. So at no point does it force a consumer to do with less than they need, which is why it's the providers who are the main source of complaint. So there are no episodes or no circumstances of which I would be aware where pricing has driven people to make poor choices about accommodation or the like. We have examples where people have chosen to pool their packages and move into housing together, and I think that's a great outcome. It's a really good outcome. It's been driven by those individuals. First of all, making a choice about who they want to live with, and secondly, what they could do differently when they did it collectively rather than just individually. And I think the more we allow that to happen, the better. But it's not price-driven; it's personal choice-driven.
Some of the organisations with really low back ends, though, are organisations like your Serco's or your ATOS's, large international combines. Does it, you know, in the dead of night, worry you that there might be predators out there thinking we'll come in, set our price low, buy the job, wipe out all the competition, then jack prices up and reduce quality?
Yep, so we have have a role of what we call being the market steward. So we're not a regulator of the marketplace. We don't have any of those ACCC type powers around predatory pricing or adverse market behaviour, but we do have a role as a market steward. And one of the things that we say is that we want to build this market so that it's, number one, well, three things. One, that it's sustainable. Two, that it's diverse. And three, that it meets people's choices. And at the end of the day, it's the third one. It'll be what people choose that drives the market. There is a lot of capacity to grow that may see new entrants coming into it. Our starting point, and why I mentioned they were quite keen to help the current providers make the transition, is for two reasons. One, I don't want to lose any capacity in the marketplace when there's such a large growth required over the next 2 or 3 years. So we want the current providers to be there. We want them to be there in the longer term. We want them to embrace growth. And the other element of that is we recognise, and some of them do it very well, some of them perhaps don't do it well, but nearly all of the non-government sector is not-for-profit organisations that have a history and legacy vested in having been created by people with disability, their families or carer-type organisations. And there is a social capital attached to that, which is important that it's retained. So we don't want a sector that is just responding on price. We want a sector that offers a diverse range of choice, and in which people with disability can say, well, I want to be with an organisation that's responsive to me, that understands that my needs and that shares my values. And if at the end of the day, circos can do that better than not-for-profits, then that's a business model. But I don't want it to be just price-driven.
Thanks. We've got other questions. Bonnie?
Hello. So I'm Bonnie, and I'm also a board director for PWDA. I'm also from South Australia, so my question will be South Australian oriented, but it will relate to rest of Australia. So as South Australia is a children's trial site, there's been a lot of media publications as the age range has not moved past 5 to 8. I guess my question is that as an advocate for youth with disabilities in South Australia, we've had a lot of concerns from parents and also youth that are tipping up to the age of 14 to 15, particularly in the 13-year-old range, that risk missing out on the trial site. So a lot of parents are concerned that they're not going to get the level of care that especially if the children have never accessed services before. So my question is, how does NDIA planners prioritise who gets what services first and why?
Okay. So the issue in South Australia is that the target group there for the trial was 0 to 14 year olds, and the number that was included in the bilateral was just over 5,000. It was wrong. It was wrong by an order of 50% or 100%. The number's at least double that. So that's one thing. It was, and in fact, we've already hit that bilateral target, as you know, and we're still in the 0 to 6-year-old age category, or now 0 to 7-year-olds. So we've hit the bilateral number, which we're resourced to do, and we've slowed down. In case, in fact, we've stopped doing new plans until the government's reached some agreement as to what the next steps are. We hope that's all imminent. By the way, this is not some new problem that just emerged. The agency pointed this out in September 2013. So it was very early in the piece we pointed out that bilateral number was wrong. Secondly, however, even within that 0 to 6 age group, we are getting more children than even we expected. And we're getting a much greater prevalence of autism and development delay in South Australia than virtually anywhere else. And don't see any causative reasons why autism should be much higher in South Australia. And when we look at the profile of that age group against all the trial sites, it's incredibly consistent for all disabilities apart from autism and development delay. And when we look at autism and development delay, it's predominantly driven by the current way in which services and supports are delivered to children. So let me use some comparisons here. South Australia has been very therapeutic driven. It's been driven very much by therapists. It's quite diagnostic based and it's getting children into therapy. Victoria has a highish number but a lower cost. Victoria's much bigger emphasis and an existing sector around early childhood intervention, which means that there is a opportunity to get a greater level of discrimination of need that you would expect when you're dealing with a spectrum disorder. New South Wales, much the same position, in fact, perhaps even stronger, with the early childhood intervention being focused around family support, things like play therapy and the like. I go over to Perth and we actually have a much lower number coming in, but very high costs. And traditionally in WA, it's been very hard to access the system, but when you got into it, you've got quite a good lot of support. So we've been looking at all of this. In fact, we started looking at this in January this year. We had some academic experts come in. We set up a reference group. We had all the consumers come in, consumers and providers come in. And I'll have to say, I thought it was a disappointing outcome of that. They did a lot of hard work, and so it was very valuable for us, but they failed to answer what I thought were three critical questions. How do you differentiate need when you're dealing with a spectrum disorder? And you can't talk about a spectrum and suggest there's a one-size-fits-all approach. Secondly, this is early intervention packages. If you're going to have early intervention, you should have an idea of what the trajectory is to lead to good outcomes. You know, what are the outcomes we're trying to achieve in terms of the development milestones, and what could we expect to see? And the third one is, and it gets to your point, is the type of intervention for a 4-year-old compared to a 6-year-old, compared to an 8-year-old, compared to a 10-year-old or 12-year-old is not the same. And you need to know the way in which supports will change over age. So we are very much looking at, and we're now piloting in the Pm Blue Mountains, where we've started early in New South Wales. We'll do it up in Townsville, where we have a new or an early start to whatever will be the Queensland rollout. We'll move it into South Australia, what we call a gateway approach, aimed at a broader early childhood intervention supports, and use that gateway to get a more individualised support package for children depending upon support needs. And I think that's very consistent with the overall philosophy of this scheme. It's really our only area of concern. But in South Australia, we're heading towards one child in 20 being eligible for the scheme, and that just doesn't ring true.
The night is no longer young. I know that we've had a lot of your time, but if you've got time, I'd like to invite one more of our social media questions from our social media wrangler. Sam, and then a question from the floor to wrap us up.
I will pick out of the 40 the WA question because I'm from WA. That's what I thought. So I'll probably be slaughtered upon arriving back if I don't ask the question. At the moment in Western Australia, we are, as you pointed out, in the middle of a trial which finishes at the end of next year. It's highly competitive. There's issues around, as you said, higher costs for providers, and there's also issues around where there's some cost shifting in the lower southwest. And money going through therapy and different costing around those sort of areas. So the party line is that it's $10,000 cheaper per participant in Western Australia, which people don't necessarily think is true. So the question is, which scheme do you think is better, David, out of the two? That's the easy question for you.
Thank you. So the first thing we should say is that I always acknowledge the strength of that WA local area coordination. In fact, we talk about the three building blocks of the NDIS being choice and control for the person, that they're at the centre of this scheme and they exercise the choice and control and that drives everything. The second, that it's an insurance scheme, so that it's about investing in people to achieve good outcomes, which is great for the person, is actually, and it makes this an economic as well as a social reform. And the third is you have to have a system that connects people to their community, because otherwise you're just leaving people disconnected and potentially isolated, albeit with more supports. And that's what the local area coordination is about when it works well. And that's a feature of the NDIS, very much picked up out of the experience in WA. I have quite a lot of people from WA who are heavily involved in the design of this scheme. Eddie Bartnick, as you would know, who was, I think, very early in the piece in setting up local area coordination in WA, later their mental health commissioner, is now a significant strategic advisor to the agency. So we honour that. We think the principal point of difference, which will need to be determined in whatever model's finally settled on, is what is the way in which you give effect to having the person with the disability exercising choice and control? And we would say that it involves giving the person the choice over how they spend their money, not just who they will choose as a provider and then have the government have the relationship with the provider. And I think that's the big fundamental issue to be reconciled with WA.
Thank you. I saw seen two questions. Just to my right.
Would people with disabilities in the near future be allowed to have legal rights and legal rights on marrying and legal rights on being allowed to have children or even foster or adopt a child, the same as someone without a disability?
So, I'll answer. Craig might want to add something as well. The NDIS is not directly in that space because that involves many, many other systems. But one of the things that is central to the NDIS is to move away from this concept of people either having or not having legal capacity and moving to a system which honours people's choices and opportunities as much as you possibly can. And so through self-advocacy, through supported decision making, we try and encourage all the other service systems to behave in the same way. That doesn't say you can't do that because you've got a disability. It says what are the supports that you might need to be able to do that. And so one of the self-advocacy groups we have in that self-advocacy resource unit in Victoria, a group called Powerful Parents, who are people with disabilities who've lost their children into out-of-home care and advocating to re-establish their parental rights and parental responsibilities. And I don't know the circumstances of everyone
there. And not being forced
there.
To have operations.
Yeah, well, certainly the legislation that sets up the NDIA has in its preface the recognition that it gives effect to at least some elements of the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, and that convention should impact across a whole range of other areas of social activity.
I was just going to note there was a quite similar but related question on Twitter, which is if somebody has a goal to express and explore their sexuality, how would the NDIS support this?
So, look, I think the starting point for that is to have an absolute acceptance that people with disability have a right to enjoy all the elements of an ordinary life, and that includes intimate and sexual relations with other people, and that the support of the NDIS should be upon assisting people as needed to make those connections to allow that to occur. I don't start with the proposition that a person with a disability can't be able to develop a relationship, including a sexual relationship, and therefore we need, you know, substituted sexual therapists to come in. I start with the proposition that people with disabilities should be able to exercise that choice and have the ability to form those relationships. Will that always occur? But maybe not, but it doesn't for a lot of other people in the community as well.
If you're happy to take one final one, I saw two hands went up at the same time. So just here.
My name is Phil Pluck. I've been a member of PWD for many years. I had two people in the family with MS. One died and the other one's still alive in a nursing home. She's under 50. Now, my question, I've learned a lot about what you say about providing service. Does equipment come into the equation?
Yes, look, equipment's a big component. Assistive technology, which includes all the current aids and appliances, is about $1 billion of the $20 billion, so it's a substantial amount. But if I could just say, because I'm quite proud of this statistic, on young people in nursing homes, which are people under the age of 50, we did an analysis in our trial sites, and 90% of the people under 50 in nursing homes in our trial sites we've got out of the nursing home and living in the community, and the other 10% include people who have chosen not to move, often because they've got significant health-related issues, or in some unfortunate cases because they were effectively in palliative stages of care. So it's a big priority area for us, is to get people out of that inappropriate type of accommodation and living in better accommodation with the equipment and the support that they need.
David, I think that actually brings us close to the end this evening. I don't know how this is compared with some of the Senate estimates committees that you front in the course of your work, but as you can see, people have lots of questions about the NDIS and are actively engaged with the scheme and care about this. And the remarks that I'd want to make and address to you is I can well remember that conversation that we had in your office about 18 months ago, which was along the lines of, would you like us to come in and select a group of random people and have them interview your clients and have them render a scorecard on your scheme, which is currently underway with about 6 reviews, I counted them at the time. And I was quite astonished that you actually said yes to that and supported that process and that transparency. I think part of that transparency is agreeing to phone up tonight and exhaust our questions. So thank you very much for that. We also appreciate the ongoing work that you're doing through, I know as a former bureaucrat, what it must be like to do an implementation like this, that you are working incredibly hard to deliver the disability support that so many of us in this organisation, which has been around through the 80s, since the 80s, have actually been fighting for. So thank you for everything that you do, for your transparency, and for being part of tonight's event. We have a small gift for you, which I'll try not to throw on the floor. I think it's fairly obvious what that might be. And it's very well deserved. We hope you might enjoy that
tonight.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks for your questions and all of your input. I will honour the commitment that any questions that have come in on social media, we will answer. Although I did make that commitment before I knew Samantha was doing the wrangling, so I might have to beg an extra week or so to get all of the replies in. But thank you, everyone.
Okay, and thanks. Thanks to all of you for your questions and your participation in tonight's AGM. I hope that you will hang around for drinks and refreshments, and we will keep in touch and see you all again next year. Thank you.
Oh, sorry.
Were
you sitting here, were you? That's Craig's bag down there.
The hotel, very tired.
Bonnie.
Oh, okay.
I haven't done that.
Bonnie.